Oh boy, what have you gotten yourself into on this mellow evening or day? I don't know. This is going to be probably a very long, I estimate at least 1.5 hours video, and it's going to be rather dense. But at the end, I hope you guys have a very solid understanding on how elliptic curve cryptography, and in particular, digital signatures work. And I will motivate it by a big use case, namely transactions on the blockchain. So even though this is an intro to elliptic curve cryptography, the first, I don't know, half an hour or so will be a close look at blockchain transactions, so we will get a sort of grasp on how they work. So this is actually in a way it's two videos in one. And the selling point is that I explain, like, I had the idea, I explain how the algorithm, the why it works. I explain it by explaining a simpler system, which is not you know, it's not a safe cryptographic system in any way, but all the elements are somewhat there. And then we'll make the jump to elliptic curves, and we look at the algorithms, and I guess you will understand how it works. So it's a little bit ambitious what I do here today, but I had this in mind for far too long, and so holiday, I sit down and I just go through that. Okay, so let's get into it. Let me move a little bit closer, and so. Okay, so first off, as I said, I do a kind of by analogy explanation, right? And I have actually several videos that go in that direction and that I want to point to. Namely, like, more than a year ago, I did this. Where is it? Explanation by analogy, blockchain one. Here I basically explain proof of work. So this is some sort of self advertisement, but I think these are good videos to look into. If you check out this video, then you might be interested in this stuff in general. And then I also talked about hash functions. Both of those that I did with Alexandra are basically by analogy function explanations. And I actually plan also to do a live coding SHA-2 or something in the future. Okay, so much for that. Actually, so we're going to talk about elliptic curve digital signature algorithms. And to my surprise, actually, there are some videos on YouTube, like, there are many kind of 10-minute clips where they try to bring across how it works, and some even do some math. So there is actually some stuff already out there. You can take a look. I suppose that's because, these kind of algorithms have a broader application than just blockchain. And I like, when I was talking about the more technical stuff in the past for blockchain, then usually I go online and you go on YouTube, and there's nothing there for the topic I want to discuss because it's a little bit too obscure. But for this stuff, there's already some stuff there. And yeah, so at the end of the video, hopefully, I will get you to the point that you understand this part. So this is how the signature is generated, right? So okay, I mean, I don't know how low level I should start, but the idea is basically, right, that you with digital signatures, that you have a way of giving your signature to a piece of data, let's say a message. And so the question is, what does it mean to have a signature? It's not like you write with your hand and pen and paper, but instead you have this way of producing certain data block, right? Some bits and bytes, and it's a signature in the sense that this signature corresponds to some secret, the private key, and only the owner of the private key can is able to produce this type of data and you know, give it away together with the message, and thereby signifying that I approve, for example, of this message. You know, the message could be, my favorite number is 7, you know, as a string of this word, and then you produce a data block that has a trace of this message in it, right? It could be the message itself or a hash, and also some new ingredients. In practice, is some numbers that are provably connected to the private key. So they can only be derived from the owner of the private key. And so if you have established that you own this the private key, so if you have established that whenever a trace of this private key, for example the public key, shows up somewhere and therefore you have an association to a person, then he or she can use this private key in this way to sign stuff. In that sense, okay. So this is basically the general motivation. Why do we even do digital signatures, right? And so there are many ways to do digital signatures, and the gist of it is that just with other cryptographic problems, the key is that there are certain operations that are hard to perform but easy to verify that it has been performed, right? And so at one point people found out, well, in the mathematics of elliptic curves, here we deal with some kind of functions, like for example this one is the one used in Bitcoin, with a few caveats, my point here being that this is not the only kind of digital signature. So, you know, there's a Wikipedia article on digital signatures in general, and they will have a chapter on elliptic curve ones, and then some alternatives. Let me see, what do you have there? Yeah, here some variants, right? And yeah, so again, elliptic curves, really, we have the same thing here. Elliptic curves are basically just this mathematical construction, right? So we might go ahead and paint a few later when we eventually end up again at this discussion. So there are some functions that describe some objects. They might look like this, but could also appear more complicated, and from the properties of this object then we can take the primitives that are, you know, we will speak about multiplication of points on the elliptic curves with numbers, and we will speak of addition of these points, whatever that means, later. And so there's a general elliptic curve cryptography. You know, here I'm just pointing you to the existence of this Wikipedia articles. A central point will be the multiplication, and you know, the operations that are possible on these geometrical objects. This is all just pure math, but again, they are used then for this algorithm. And here we have these several steps. I will not go through them now in detail, but at the end of the video, you will be able to get an idea of what all of these points here mean and why it works and how it works. So there's the one part where you generate a signature. In the end, this will be this pair of numbers here, R and S, called R and S. And then the verification part is another algorithm that takes this R and S and verifies them and confirms, oh yeah, there must have been the owner of this private key who has signed this this message, and this is this is the stuff. Basically, this is the stuff. If you're talking blockchain now, this is the stuff that's implemented, for example, in any wallet. You know, if you go on an online wallet and you have it in your browser, you say, I want to do this and that, invoke that smart contract, or make this transaction of funds, and then you create a message, you sign it, we will see how that looks. And then on the other side, you know, the nodes in the network, they all receive the query that you want to make, the transaction that you produced and broadcasted to the network. They receive the stuff that you generated in your wallet. This is just basically a few zeros and ones, a few kilobytes of data. And then they will do the verification. Actually, we will later look at the Bitcoin code in the repository, and not in detail, but basically this verification side is implemented there. And if everything works well, then the nodes will execute the transaction and run the smart contract or put the currency transaction on the block. Okay, so this is for starters. Should I close this now? Maybe not yet. I want to point to some resources. I will also put them in the box at the bottom. I think this was at one point posted in the Y Combinator blog series or so. I don't know. So this is a nice article with pictures discussing elliptic curve signatures for Bitcoin, and there is a big overlap to what I will discuss, and I might come back to this very web page later because they have the nice graphs and stuff like that. And also, you know, we will go through this stuff later. But what I want to get at is to understand why elliptic curve cryptography works. Eventually, we want to end up understanding this line here. So here you have the R and the S is basically the S is this thing, this side, right? You have the R and the S, and this is what is generated, and we will see why that amounts to a signature from a private key. So in this equation, like, we will come to that later again, but you know, this X is the private key. Exactly. And this R and this S will be the signature, and M will be the message. And we will later understand why this kind of line is of significance. Okay. So I leave that open. I think I can actually close that again. And then, of course, you know, there's the Bitcoin Wiki. These articles are usually short, but they also give you some information. I will actually come to that page again later as well. So this is discussing the curve that is used for Bitcoin in particular. You know, there are infinitely many elliptic curves that you could use. Nakamoto decided for one, and basically, like, most of the projects after, like, even Ethereum and so on, they go with the same math and this exact same choices. And we will also get to understanding all these numbers here. Did I close this? Wait a minute. Yeah, I guess I did. So there is also I just Googled into it to find a quick reference. It's a little bit more formal than the Wikipedia entry, and I found this paper, and this is basically the same algorithm that we had before, right? So you can look at this if you are interested in a little bit more details, a little bit more formality, of course, you know, any mathematics Springer book on this sort of cryptography will do it as well. That's what I said before. There are some nice there are a bunch of videos already on this stuff, more or less former, mostly are pretty short, so you might look into that, but this video will also be a lot a lot of info about the transaction, so this is of course a better video. Let me actually okay, so we'll need that later. I can close that. Here is the Bitcoin GitHub, and if you go to Bitcoin, and I think this is, yeah, Bitcoin source, and then there's the Elliptic Curve folder, and it has another source folder inside, and this is the stuff where here again you see the R and the S, so they are even using the same letters, and here's the verification and all this kind of stuff. If you want to look into that, be aware that if you look into the repository and source, this Elliptic Curve stuff is not under crypto, because under crypto they have, I don't know, the hash functions and so on and so forth, and the Elliptic Curve things are in their own folders, just for your information. Okay, we don't need that anymore, this is nothing. Do we already want to get into that? I suppose so. So this is Etherscan, right? This is the Ethereum blockchain, and I'm just here on some random address. I don't know, some exchange or whatever. Oh no, exactly. This is the smart contract for EOS. So obviously this video has nothing to do with EOS, but that's just an example. So before we dive into all the Elliptic Curve cryptography stuff and the transaction stuff, we must, to not alienate everybody, I must kind of explain the interplay between the strings and byte arrays and zeros and ones and hexadecimal expressions and how that actually relates to math. So I will lose a few words on the relation between different representations, right? So for example, if you just take this contract address, right? You have this 0x, meaning this is a hexadecimal expression, and then a bunch of characters. These are numbers from 0 to 9, as well as A, B, C, D, E, F. So 16 different characters. And one thing you definitely must understand, and I hope this is not too basic. If it's too basic, then be sure it will get a little bit more trickier later. One thing to understand is that all these kind of expressions are really just numbers, right? They are like just numbers in a different base system. So if you have 9 or 10 symbols, like 0 to 9, and then you use the decimal system, and you can express all your numbers with these systems. If, for example, you use binary system, only zeros and ones, then you can represent numbers in binary. And of course, they will be the same numbers, the same integers, except they are represented differently, right? I will show you this in a second in Python, actually. And if you want to use more than 2 or more than 10 symbols, then you can, for example, go for 16. Then you have this hexadecimal. So this is also just an integer represented in one way or another. And if you later have transactions, Bitcoin transactions, for example, then these will also, they will look like this, basically. There will be information be encoded in hexadecimals, usually. What I'm saying is basically, this is on one hand, this is a sequence of zeros and ones, underneath, practically speaking. You know, two such characters here are one byte or whatnot. You know, it's, a byte is 8 zeros and ones. So eventually you can break down all these expressions to a sequence of zeros and ones, but they also represent integers. So if you see one, you should be convenient in understanding them in those other two ways as well, right? Either a sequence of zeros and ones, or sequence of information, or just one number. It's the same thing, like a thing and relation. And for example, this is the EOS smart contract, right? This is a token smart contract, and the token that can be sent around on the Ethereum blockchain. And if you're an Etherscan, then you can look at the contract with, this is just a mask with information, but no, the contract looks like that, right? So they have, there's somewhere transact, it's this is mathematics stuff, and then minimum, maximum, total supply balance. So this is just a piece of code that is written by some programmer, but then this smart contract is compiled to some bytecode, and I mean bytecode just means, you know, a sequence of bytes, and then you have this, like this, the same smart contract that you have here, you also have here, but in a compressed machine readable form, and this is also really expressed just for our convenience, so to speak, in hexadecimal, right? You can also translate that to zeros and ones. So the first thing to understand is basically this is just information, right? This is some sort of representing this contract that where you can do this kind of stuff and so on. And this is also, this is basically the same contract. And you can go in this direction from the contract to this, the byte array, and to some extent also in the other direction. I mean, there's some compilation of a computer program in between, which maybe makes things efficiently, more efficiently for the machine to read, but so this is my point is just a sequence of information, and also this, the whole thing as such is a number, really, right? And when you say, oh, I want to deploy my contract to the blockchain, then you send this up to some node that they dump it on the blockchain. It's, you send it away like a transaction, right? Okay, and so we will now do some Python to get your feel for that, because we will see all the transactions and this kind of math all the time. So let's better get familiar with that. Yeah. So if you have a Mac, you can actually already use Python, but because it comes pre-installed, and Windows not. I'm not too sure about the Linux operating systems, but okay, I have here Python, right? I can do some math. And the first thing I want to show you is how different bytes are represented in different formats. So what we can do is here, we get say fork an integer k running from 0 to 256, so that's I guess 2 to the power of 11. Let's print, we print here stuff. Okay, first for show I will just print k, so he will print out all these numbers, all right? But we want actually to see more. We want k, and we want the character that's associated with k, and then we want also this k in different bases. So we say, let's see, hex, and that's also the binary. So I will print now for all these 264 integers from 0 to 255. All these four formats. Okay, and so here you see them in this is all just the same thing but in different representation. So this, the zero, right? So this is the integer k. Then this is the same integer but in hexadecimal. This is this thing, right? He cannot display the character for that one, but okay. And the binary expression for zero is also just zero, right? But if you, for example, go to five, right? The number five in decimal is represented by this symbol. In binary, it's 101, because that's 2 to the power of 0 plus nothing plus 2 to the power of 2. So this is 4 plus 1 makes 5, right? And in hexadecimal, which has 16 characters, you know, the 5 is one of the 16, so we can also use the 5. Now, if we go, for example, to 23, then in hexadecimal, that would be 17, because it's 7 times 6 to 16 to the power of 0, so 7, plus 1 times 16 to the power of 1, so it's 16 plus 7, which makes 23, right? And in binary, it's 10111. Because this is 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus not 8 plus 16. So 16 plus 4 is 20 plus 2 is 22 plus 1 is 23. So it works out, right? Some of those characters cannot be represented in this terminal, but all these numbers, like let's go for, I think later we will look at this one here. You know, the number 81 in hexadecimal, it's 51 because it's, you know, 1 plus 16 to the power of 5 times 16 to the power of 1, I suppose, right? Is 81. And it's this binary string of zeros and ones. But it's also this character, right? So for each of these characters that you see everywhere, you can also assign a number. Of course, this relation is kind of arbitrary, right? This is just the next character. But we can actually go also the other direction. So we can here do... either you go the char or character for let's say, what did you have? 81. So that would be Q. But you can also go to go in the other direction. Right, so we can do... I don't know. For character in hello, print ord character, right? And so hello correspond to these numbers. So for example, O will correspond to the integer 111. Let's check that here. 111 is O, right? So L appears two times, so we have this. And so kind of the point I want to make is that, of course, this is just a decimal representation, but we can also look at the hexadecimal representation, right? So so the sequence 6 8 6 5 6 C 6 C 6 F, and it's an accident that there are so many sixes in this word. This would represent hello if you always take two characters, hexadecimal characters at a time, right? So this means hello basically. Or if we go with in this encoding, of course, the binary, right? If you have this sequence, you know, one da da one. You know, if I copied that correctly. So this string of zeros and ones, that would amount in this encoding to hello, right? But then you have, of course, give to information, you know, every eight represent one character by taking the number. You know, this number would be 104 and translating it to the character, like this SC character that corresponds to it, and so in this way, right, you can send information, and the information that we will see in the next basically chapter of this video will be on Bitcoin transactions, and then we will see a lot of sequences of hex bytes. So for example, if I actually take this address, like this is the address of the EOS smart contract, then I can take it and like I can for one look at the integer that corresponds to, like in this going from hex to integer, for example, like decimal representation. So I see that the smart contract of EOS is actually like identified by this number on the chain, right, on the Ethereum blockchain. And going in the other direction, you know, there's this one-to-one correspondence. Here, it doesn't distinguish between upper or lowercase characters, right? Because there are only 16 different symbols. And So here the reading is that I just applied is basically to see this whole thing as one large, you know, number. And another reading that will be common is like to look at these symbols in pairs of two and interpret them as a byte that represent, for example, a character or some set of instructions and so on and so forth. And you can imagine that, you know, if I were to send you the word hello, I can first translate it to this sequence. Sadly, I deleted it already. Yeah. And transactions over the internet work by, you know, essentially sending the stream of zeros and ones. And I can, like, if you know that the protocol, that the way of how the context of how to interpret the data, then I can just send you the zeros and ones and you will understand this and can unpack the information on the other end, on your node, on your server, on the client side, or wherever you are. Okay. Was it everything I want to cover here? Let me see. Why do we have this open actually? Let's actually, so this is the Bitcoin wiki, right? As an example for how this is also relevant, of course, for Bitcoin and not for Ethereum, like being in the space, I always get the feeling that, the innovation of Ethereum over Bitcoin is slightly, like exaggerated by the people who don't program, because a lot of the functionality and ideas of Ethereum are already in Bitcoin, right? So, for example, the language of on the Bitcoin nodes that is used to interpret the messages is called a script. It's a very creative name for a scripting language, I guess. And we will look at the transactions, and which is basically a sequence of bytes, right? And then there are codes, like the node interprets this message as a sequence of codes. And if you have this script language, for example, and it is the same thing on Ethereum or Neo or whatever, then you always have that, for example, one byte. This would be represent one byte. Basically, this is the 76 possible byte, right? And it will correspond to some operation, and here you have the plain text description what it does, like what the node is instructed to do. So you can plug together a bunch of bytes, and the Bitcoin node will interpret the bytes that he gets as some instructions what he can do, and the Bitcoin transactions works by having a transaction be a small script. Then instruct him how what to do basically on the blockchain. You know, do the verification of the signature and change the ledger to take account the new transaction that is being invoked. So what do we have here? Yeah, here we have, for example, the number 81 that I was taking as an example before. In hex, it is 51. You know, this is really just what we had here. Right, so this would correspond to the letter Q, but I mean that's not necessarily interesting here for this Bitcoin script, but this is basically the 81th possible byte, and this is represented in hex like this, and it means for the Bitcoin script that the number one is pushed onto the stack, so the Bitcoin like node virtual machine quotes and quotes has the stack, and then I will not go into much more detail on how it's to plug together the transaction, but I will show you how a transaction look to motivate where the signature, the signing comes in, right? Okay. And exactly to understand the Bitcoin transaction, what the Bitcoin transaction really is, I found this article, which comes in two parts. It's probably pretty old, but it's very it has everything packed together nicely, and it's pretty informative. Man, so much advertisement. How do I? Okay. So what I want to get, like, I will not go through the article in detail, but the interesting thing is really this. So this is the deconstruction of a Bitcoin transaction. He has the Bitcoin transaction as a plain text binary here. So this would be a transaction that you would create with your wallet and send to to some Bitcoin nodes and have them executed. And as I said before, right, this is, you can read this as like, this is a byte, and so on. This is a bunch of bytes, and in a protocol in general amounts to an rules of how to interpret them, right? I mean, without context, this is just basically this is just a number, right? Actually, let's look at what number this is, just for the sake of it. It might be that he has a problem with the trailing one at the beginning. Okay, let's skip that. So it might have a problem because here's a one and I didn't do like 0x, and so he tells me this is a syntax error. But okay, it doesn't really matter. Obviously, this is also just a sequence characters between 0 and F, so 16 different. So you can interpret this thing that I highlighted in blue here as some number, right? So you send this number, and everything is, again, not to iterate this, everything is just a sequence of information encoded in one way or another, and one basic way is just to view this information as an integer, and that can be also represented in different bases. So in any case, this nice sequence here, yeah, it starts with 0, 1, and then a bunch of 1s, and 1, 4, 1. This really, here, 0, 1, and then 1, 4, 1. This is the taking apart of this message, right? So we can quickly go through that. You know, we have a version number for the type of transactions, and then the number of inputs, and later the number of outputs is basically how much unspent transaction, like, you know, Bitcoin, for example, has this unspent transaction model where you choose a transaction in the past where the money has not been yet spent, and then in this transaction you specify which one you want to, you know, unlock again, which unspent outputs you want to spend. This is this these inputs, and then they go as outputs to another address. And actually it might help if we skip a little bit forward to this thing. So I have searched out for some, you know, this is a Bitcoin Block Explorer. This is some address which is the hash of the public key, and we will come to, it's actually the double hash of a public key, and we will come to what a public key is in mathematical terms later. But I mean, here's some user, he has an account. I think this might be some exchange as well. He has a bunch of Bitcoin. And so for example, let's look here. Here, that was 2 days ago on December 26th. This is a bad example. Okay, let's because there's stuff mined or whatnot. Let's look at this here. So, this is a transaction. This is the ID of the transaction, right? This is also, again, this is just some hex string. And money came from these two addresses, and, you know, pulled together here this basically 88 Bitcoin from there, 88 Bitcoin from there, and they went to these two addresses. So he has a bunch of Bitcoin there and a bunch of Bitcoin there, and you see that from this interaction where money went from these two to these two addresses, this 168, they have already again been spent later. So there is, if I were to go to this address, unless it's the same where I am, yeah. If I were to go to this address, then I would see that at one point money came in from here and is already spent. But this at this point in time is unspent Bitcoin, right? So this is this Bitcoin came to this address with this transaction and still reside there. That's why it says here this U for unspent. And so if I had the private keys corresponding to this address here, then I could say, ah, okay, here are some unspent coins, right? So I take the ID of these transactions, and from this ID I want to spend some of those unspent transactions. I want to send them somewhere else. And I can only do that if I have to produce the transactions, which say, you know, take exactly this money and send it somewhere else where I wanted to send it. Like, for example, let's say I want to send this seven Bitcoin also to this address, so he has even more on this address. Then I can construct the transactions that say, you know, redirect, dispatch this money to that address, and send it to the Bitcoin network. But the Bitcoin network will, before it does actually perform these transactions on each individual node, before the nodes say, yeah, okay, let's put that to our you know, chain of blocks, they will check if these transactions is actually signed by a private key that corresponds to the public key that is hashed to this address, right? So only if I have the private key to move money away from this one, then this constructed transaction will be approved. And this was a short detour, but this was just to say that if I want to send Bitcoin, then I have to state in the transaction that I construct what is actually the previous transaction. So this transaction would be like 0e da 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 da. This would go into this field, basically. This is what starts from here to there, I suppose. Exactly. So this is, no, here. This part is a transaction hash on the blockchain. This is basically one of those numbers. The index is not very interesting. The version number is also not interesting. Let's skip that for a second. And then you say, how much do you want to spend? So let's say I wanted to, I see, oh, he has, you know, 7.9 here. Let's say I want to spend 7.5, right? Then I would put it here. And again, I would have to translate it to hex, right? So let's say, this is like improvised, but if I go with, what is the format? 7.5 Bitcoin, and then I don't know how many decimals. This is just a blind guess, right? Let's say I want to spend this many Satoshis, then the amount or whatever would be the amount in hex, and this is the number that is here, right? I mean, sure, I got the digits now wrong, like it will probably be more digits, but just so if you wonder, this value is the amount of money just expressed in hexadecimals, and then maybe even the order is, you know, wrong way around or whatever, but this that's not the point, but this is the amount. And here is basically the instruction what to do. So this block here, this unlock script, this will be related to the elliptic curve signature, and I show you in a second how it looks like in more detail. But here is also a sequence of bytes, and this is a short smart contract, if you will. This is a short script that says, okay, if you get this transaction, if you get the whole thing, then he will run that thing, or in roughly speaking, in like, you know, it's translated to something that, and here it says, here's a sequence of opcodes. For example, it starts with this 7.6, and if we still have it open, I think this is one of the, you know, push data to the stack, blah, blah, blah. And then I could try to figure out, like, he has probably like how much data put, like, this is some smart contract. This is basically like the EO smart contract, except much simpler. And the Bitcoin the Bitcoin nodes have a not Turing complete, you know, stack machine-y kind of thing that executes that. And this this script refers back to the whole transaction. So here you have a bunch of input data. This is like the invocation in input data, and this will be executed. And here it says, you know, take this this data and look at the public key that is actually buried here as well, and do this this check of if the signature is right, and then if everything is right, then actually put the new transaction on the blockchain, given that, you know, consensus is found by the whole network and so on and so forth. So this is I guess this was a more or less decent explanation how this bunch of symbols is the transaction. And if you have a nice you know, a terminal tool to analyze transaction, then it will actually take that and he will deserialize it, meaning he will actually show you maybe a JSON formatted thing where it tells you exactly what is the output and so on and so forth. Okay, so in this blog he explains everything in more detail regarding this transaction. Blah blah blah. Very nice. He explains like what the opcodes are that are actually, you know, part of the script that I talked about, and there's apparently some debugger where you can run it through. That's some. Okay, and then if you go to page 2, come on. So he will actually go with you, like in details, how to construct the signature. And here at the bottom, he has, yeah, exactly. So this block here, right? This is the script that I will not explain in more detail, but you have to, you know, push and compare and whatever, whatnot. This is the amount. This is the transaction that's in question. And then you have here the unlocking script. Basically, here must go the public key and the signature that gives the right to actually unlock the money from this previous transaction. This 6A, this is just the length of this block. Basically, it tells you, like, it tells the script then, okay, how much data should he load to the stack or whatnot. We can actually look at what is 6A. Int 0x6A. So he tells us 106 divided by 2. So this would be probably 53 or so bytes or whatnot, right? Or maybe that's already the byte and the division by 2 is not necessary. But in any case, so this is just a number of how much information. Yeah, and I think this as well, like this says there are 21 bytes coming. Here this says 47 bytes incoming. So this block here, starting with 47 and ending with DA, he has in a refined explanation above. So okay, this is this block, right? It starts with 47 and ends with DA. So this is the same as we saw before, but actually even more explained what these numbers are. So everything after the 21, this is actually the public key. This is basically the address from which you want to send, like in our case, like if you were to wanted to send this thing, then it would be the public key underlying the hash here. So if you take this public key as an integer and hash it 2 times, then we get the address. This would be like, look like something like this. It has this length. I will explain what a public key, like this is actually the compressed public key, what it is in a second. So that's that. And here you already see, like, here's header again, it's not interesting, but here you have these things that we saw at the very beginning, right? Here you have this R and S. So these are the numbers that make for the digital signature. And, The next, what, I don't know, 40 minutes or so, the rest of the video, that will consist in explaining where these numbers come from. So the idea is that, right, you start with, hey, I want to send this money, I know the value, I know where it comes from, I know the public key, and I know the previous transaction where that has the unspent money that I want to spend. And then the only thing you have to do is provide the digital signature that corresponds to this public key that you actually have to write to spend it, and then the network will accept it. Here in this article, he does not, like, he explains how to construct the transaction, but he doesn't explain how to create the signature. He just uses the elliptic curve digital signature algorithm package from Python. So I think here he imports, you know, the hash library, the elliptic curve library, the SC character library, the Bitcoin curve in particular, and he explains that, you know, to sign the transaction and sign it, like to take the message that is the transaction in incomplete form and then hash it and then sign it, you take the unsigned thing, and then you write the hash, that's a trace of the message that you want to sign, and then, you know, here a private key. This is also just the private key is just a number. We will get to that later. But here you see some private key in hex form, and we will, in this case, it's actually interesting. So this is the private key in decimal form, right? It's some huge number, but I want to it will be relevant for the algorithm part later. The private key is really just a number, and it's just a number that, spoiler ahead, that you multiply with some point on the elliptic curve, and what multiplying a point means we'll see later. So here's the private key, and, you know, if you know Bitcoin private key, they might also look like that. They might not have only numbers up to F, but they might have more numbers than that. That's because this is I don't know, a base 58, and then, you know, check summed a version of that. So this is again the same thing as that, from the in information standpoint, is just another encoding, like one that has more characters, not just 16 but 58 or something like that. I mean, you can actually look at the Bitcoin wiki. They have nice articles on that, base or encoding. Yeah, right, so they explain to you how to give give an example. So here's the correspondence, I suppose, of numbers and letters, and they also have this VIF, you know, there's also that different, even on Bitcoin, different formats. So this is a private key, this is some number in hex, and then they explain to you how to create the checksum and how to do this base encoding, and then the private key will look like that. And then there are also the other ones which don't start with a 5 or whatnot, but start with an L. Okay, this is also all beside the point, I suppose. But yeah, he uses then this Python algorithm tools to take the private key, then create this elliptic curve object which spits out signatures, and then he uses this object, inputs the message, this is this transaction hash, and then he gets the signature out, and the signature in hex format, this is just a conversion, looks like that. And then this is the signed version of the transaction, and then he just starts with 3344. And this is exactly this 3044. This is exactly that. So this is the algorithm which spits out the R and the S. You know, this is somehow buried in here. If you're looking, we can 02. I'm too stupid now to find it, but. This is in any case this, so it ends in 4F and ends in bad, and 4F. So I suppose this is the S, for example. Exactly. This is the S, and then this is probably the the R. So this is the thing that is produced, and we will see how to produce that at the end of this video. Okay, we can actually there's this very I don't want to say user unfriendly wallet, but it's like very like a developer kind of wallet where you can actually create your own raw transactions and not just, you know, usually if you download the Bitcoin wallet, everything works, it's like happening under the hood, and you just enter the private key maybe, or you enter like some encoded version of it or whatnot, or some pin, and then you say what you want, you know, this amount and this address, and then you will do everything under the hood. But you can also do, of course, you know, as you see here, do it basically with pen and paper. And so we can actually try to, you know, how far we get with spending that. So there's this address, right? And it has presumably still this 8 Bitcoin, maybe more. And Docker wants something from me. No, thank you. So let's go there. Okay, he has not spent this eight bitcoins. This was the only transaction. We can now go to this website and create a new transaction. And this is very nice. You can say, hey, I want the information for this. Okay. So there are different addresses. This is one which starts with 3. Maybe I find a simpler one. Let me see. The problem is that I don't know how up to date all these sites are, and you know. Come on. Okay, so let's go back in time a little bit, so that hopefully he has all the information. We look into this blog, which transactions happened there. Man, this is so slow. I just want one Bitcoin address. God damn it. Okay. Let's scratch that demonstration. But basically, what ought to happen here is that here you can basically say, oh, I want the information for this address. And maybe actually, that's very sad. Very sad. Maybe he has a simpler one on this page that I already had. No, I don't know. Okay, sorry for that. So what would happen is I load this, and then he would list here all the transactions that would be the IDs, right, the hashes, and that would be this is the part where you enter the script that you want to enter. Basically, you would enter this script, and then he spits out. You say submit, and then he gives you the transaction, basically the one without the signature, and then here you would enter the private key, and then he would literally dump the hex code, and then he would produce the end result. Basically, this is just an online tool to do exactly that, right? So and then you know you would again, you know, copy paste it and transmit it to the network. And so this is basically in a more raw sense how you create a transaction. I would have loved to show you how to do that and see me fail, because I don't know the private key, of course, but so that's really the practical application. So let's see how long this video already is. Okay, I'm actually at the 1 hour mark. Very nice. So let's see if I can do the rest in half an hour. So we were already here. So this is the elliptic curve. And as I said, I will actually explain how the algorithm works or why it works. I will not start with the elliptic curve, but with a simpler curve. namely just one simple exponential function, right? And so I will talk about an analogous mathematical framework or theory, because it has many similarities, and I can actually showcase what is happening and why with two numbers like R and S you can prove identify yourself based on the private key. One second. Okay. So, the one thing that's important to understand here is that, in fancy terms, any exponential function is a homomorphism. It mediates between, like in the case of the exponential function, it mediates between addition and multiplication. And so what I mean by that is the following. Exponentiation, right, is just like repeated multiplication. So b, some number, n, some number, some natural number. B to the power of n means multiply b n times with itself, right? So what results from that is this nice rule here, right? So let's do a practical example. So let's say b is 3, right? And n let be 5. And so b to the power of, in Python is star star. So b to the n is this number, right? And obviously this number is just b multiplied by itself 5 times, right? This is just 3 times 3 times 3 times 3 times 3. And then if n is, I don't know, 2, then b to the power of n, and this number times b to the power of m is this. And really this is just b times b times b times b times b times b times b, and then times b times b, right? So this is b to the power of 5, b to the power of 2, and this is really also just obviously b to the power of 7, right? This is all the same number. And this happens to be this, right? So this is just an example of this relation. And the fancy thing here is that the exponentiation, right, this to the power of, as you can see, it mediates between multiplication and addition. You have two different operations, two algebraic operations. Down below you have the multiplication, up here you have addition. And now you have a way to compute this number in two different ways, right? Either you can do the exponentiation first on both sides and then multiply the result, or you do the simpler addition first and then do only one exponentiation. In both cases you will come to the same result, right? As a consequence of that as well, results this law, right? So if we do let's say k is 3, right? Then if you do b to the power of m, so this will be 3 to the power of 2, right, to the power of k, and this is this number, obviously this is just 3 times 3 times, yeah, so, and this to the power of 3, right, yeah. And this is the same as 3 times 3. So, right? So if you do this double exponentiation, then this, you can break this down to the b's again, right? This is also just, you know, the b's multiplied by itself 6 times. So this is just this. And in the end, that means this is just m times k, right? So we have this on the one hand and this on the other hand. This is the same thing. So if we exponentiate something exponentiated again, then we can instead just multiply first and do one exponentiation, right? Here's two exponentiations. Here's only one exponentiation because we replaced the second one with the simpler multiplication. And similarly with the addition here, right? There's a way to spare ourselves the exponentiation. And so what does that mean for this graph, right? So here what I do is I have the same b actually, like I said, b equals 3. And I say 3 to the power of x, and I let the x go from, in this case, from minus 4 to 4. Here, right? So we can do this here actually. We can do 3 to the power of 0, right? This is 1. So this is a little bit, we cannot really see this here nicely. I can do a plot a little different. So if we plot not so much and zoom in a little bit, God, so then we see that 3 to the power of 0, like this is the x-axis, 3 to the power of 0 is actually 1. Then 3 to the power of 1 is 3. So 3 to the power of 1, so here's the 1. This will be 3, right? On this level we have 3. And then 3 to the power of 2 is 9. So this goes on. On 2 we are on the level 9. And so if we go back to this graph, over 2 we are at 9. And then over 3, 3 to the power of 3, this is 27. We will be here. 3 to the power of 4 is 9 times 9 is 81. So this will like explode and be already there, right? 3 to the power of 4, exactly. So, and how is the rule that we just described how can we view this rule that we just described, the exponentiation rule, in this graph? Well, we have, for example, that 3 to the power of 3 is the same as 3 to the power of 2 times 3 to the power of 1, right? So because this was, this rule here. Maybe I should, where that works. Maybe I do it the other way around. Let me just to have the coinciding notation with the Wikipedia article. So we have this here, right? So 3 to the power, like, b is 3 in this case, n is 2, m is 1. We have this relation, and if we compute it, it says, yeah, that's valid. How is this depicted in this graph? Well, easy. It says that if we have here 1 and here 2, right? So this is the height of this here is the value of this one, like, 3. The height of this one is the value of that one, it's 9. And it says that if you take any two points here on the x-axis and add them together, wherever we get there, if we look at the height of the graph, then the new result will be the multiplication of the points there. So, okay, let's view this in more detail here. So if I take 1 and 2 and add them together, I get 3, right? And here I get this height, and here I get that height. And if I multiply these two heights together, right, this is just this side, what I get here is, what I get as a result of that is another height, and then the height will exactly hover over the point that comes from the addition. So a more complicated example would be, the problem with this exponential function is that you cannot really, it doesn't, the numbers become so big that you cannot really see what's going on anymore. Yeah, the graph is ridiculous. But the point is that, for example, if I take the number 7 here, like x equals 7, and here Nick, x equal 20, yeah, x equal 20, right? Then the blue line hovers at some point over 7. How much? Let's see. 3 to the power. Okay, so the value of the function, the blue line over 7 is 2187. And it hovers somewhere over 20 as well, like a bigger number. Okay, this is the number. It's already, we cannot see it on this graph, but it's already super big, right? So there are like two numbers here. And now to know what the result of multiplying these two points is, like to know what is the outcome of this times the outcome of this, like what is the result of multiplying the heights like over the graph over the x axis. Well, by what we just discussed, it's the same as the height of the blue line over, in this case, 27. So because we had the 7 and 20, and then there's a point 27, and the height of the blue line here is exactly the multiplication of the heights of those, right? So this is a relation of, this is an algebraic relation that's encoded in this graph, because this is a simple algebraic relation. We happen to be able to plot this on that graph, even if you cannot really see much for the exponential function because it explodes so heavily. But the point is that we can either do, like, let's say we have the perfect graph and we can look at all the numbers. To multiply these numbers, right? We could just walk along the line and look at how high the graph is, right? If I would not have my computer here, if I could not do this multiplication here, and I wanted to know what are these two numbers, what is the product of 3 to the power of 2, of, budget, 3 to the power of 7, so what is the product of the height here, and what is multiplied by the height of this point. If I had a perfect picture of this graph lying around somewhere, if a kid drew it with a pen on the ground, then instead of doing the multiplication, like instead of doing algebra, I could just look at the graph and I figure out how much that is, right? The graph captures the algebraic properties, and the point is that an elliptic curve also encodes and points that fit together nicely with an algebraic manipulation, and that would be this is one part, the elliptic curve multiplication. Before we go to that, I want to point out that the major difference is that, for one, the elliptic curve, by the way, this is only the upper half of the elliptic curve, right? So this is actually should also go down here. The algebraic operations of that you do with the points on the elliptic curve are more complicated and much more, they're of a different character computationally. And this is, I don't know, maybe this is what is like the fancy math that you have, for example, in probably on the elliptic curve Wikipedia page. So let's go. Let's go there. So this is some graph corresponding to this equation, right? And it has some points, just in the same sense that the x value 0.7 and the y value 2187. This is a point on the exponential curve, and on the elliptic curve you also have some points, like points that are valid there, and then I will get to this later, but basically here you also have a way of adding points together, like I did with the exponential one, and this is such that the point that results from adding two points is again also on the elliptic curve. Okay, I can actually like skip forward and explain that directly. I think a good visualization is here on this this article. So what you do is you say you want to add 2 points, let's say this P and Q, right? So to get the result of the elliptic curve addition of these 2 points, you draw a connecting line between the two. Then the curve is such that it will cut, in almost all cases, the curve at 1 point. Like here, there's this point here in which it is cut. And then what you do, he draws it. And then what you do is you mirror this point up to the other half of the elliptic curve, right? And so this R is then the result of the addition. So you have this strange kind of curve that is given by some simple algebraic equation. And then you can define in a certain way a new addition. And of course, the addition is graphically represented, but if he is nice enough, he will also tell us in more detail how that works, maybe not. But there's of course also formulas, like this graphical representation of the addition corresponds to some, simple to derive formulas, and that is surely given here on these pages somewhere. Well, again, we will not actually go into the detail and do it with the elliptic curve as such, but my point is just that here, like with the exponential curve, you can add points in a certain way, right? And that's just one ingredient. And we but now let's actually do what I wanted to get at with exponentiation. But before that, I have to actually plug in my laptop because I'm running out of power. Give me a second. So well prepared. Okay. Okay, so here we go. Let's go back to this graph, right? So the nice thing is that in a certain sense, like you have noticed, I'm only doing integer operations here. So even though this line is some smooth line, and the same is true with the elliptic curve, right? It's represented here over the real numbers. But in reality, I'm actually only interested in using discrete numbers, and I will come to some caveats at the end of the video regarding that. But basically, I guess you can here do list plot. Okay, now in Mathematica you would understand it, but basically what counts is really not the whole line but only the integer points, right? I'm only interested in integer points here, and these happen to be also integer points, like the heights happen to be integer points. Okay, so what's interesting here is that the 3 to the power of 1, right, this is 3 again, and you know, I'm dealing with 3 here, but I can also do the same with 70, right? Everything I said I can also do with bigger numbers, but I just stick to small numbers so the numbers stay small, and you know, you can see what happens. But what's special is that over the number 1 here, x equals 1, the height is exactly the base rate, right? It's 3 in this case exactly. And in a sense, you can generate all numbers on the curve from that number by exponentiation. Namely, so if I say g, this is my base point here, right? G equals 3. Then to go to this point here, right? This 3, or yeah, now let's go here, 4 and 81 as we've seen. Well, I can generate this from g, right? I can say, Well, the x coordinate I want to be like, let's say x equals 4, and my x coordinate is this, and then my y coordinate is g to the power of x. This is basically just a function, right? Y is the base to the power of x, and so y would be 7 in this case. Oh, sorry, I wrote to the power, but of course in Python it's so. And you can also, like, let's say there is, like, we have this point, and this point is really the base shifted, like, from one to another point, basically. Like, if I wanted to go to the point over 50, right, the, like, g to the power of 50, then I would, the x value would be 50, and the y value would be, like, this value 3 pumped up, you know, times itself 50 times. So in a way, all points are generated from here, you could say, right? Exponentiation of this point given by 1 and g, right? This is this point. It has x coordinate 1 and y coordinate g. Exponentiation puts you to all other points. So, for example, 2 and g to the power of 2 is this. 2, 9, 3, 27. So these are all these points. For example, we can now go 4k k in range, I don't know, 10,000, print, and then this point, let's go with x. For x coordinate, print x and g to the power of x. Right, and now he would print out all these 10,000 points. So maybe I went a little bit too far. Let's go to the hundreds. So these are all points that lie on this curve, right? So in a sense, this base point that generates the all other points, right, that come after it. And so when we look at the elliptic curve, let's actually go to the Bitcoin wiki. Where was the Bitcoin wiki? Did I close it? Okay. Okay, so I want to have the sec curve here. So this is the curve, except, you know, modulo these caveats, here we also start with one point that is actually on the curve, and this is the point G, this base point. This is encoded in some number here, the whole algorithm functions around this base point, and this base point basically corresponds to the base, like, that we till now denoted by the number 3, for example, in our exponential case. But this has to be just one point on the curve. Like, strictly speaking, our point was this 1, 3. If we would take another exponential curve, like, for example, 11 to the power of x, right, then the base point would be 1, 11, or the analogous thing to the base point anyway. What we have here is the base point for one thing, and now let's go to the actual signature thing. So Yeah. So what we have is that any Bitcoin private key, right? We have talked about private keys before. For example, in this here where he was creating the signature. So private key might look like that. This is also just some number, and we will denote the private key by D, simply because the Wikipedia page, I think, does that as well. And now for this example, for our, exponential function private key, signature thing, let's say my private key is 14. I choose small numbers, so everything, can be understood, like it can fit on the screen. So D is my private key. I don't share it with anybody. Now from my private key, I can generate a public key. And I do this by just exponentiating the base, right? Our base was G, and so G to the power of D will be some other number, and this will actually not be my public key, right? If I would take this and hash it 2 times, that would correspond to my address on the blockchain, for example. And in here I have exponentiation. In the elliptic curve case, maybe he does that even here as well. Well, in the elliptic curve case anyway, what happens is this: the exponentiation in the exponential curve case, I mean, doesn't exist here because it's another kind of curve. But what you do is, I think it does it actually. Yeah. So instead of exponentiation, you do this multiplication of a point on the elliptic curve times a number. So what for us would be, the base point to the power of 14 in the elliptic curve case, that would be multiplication of our private key number times the base point. The base point is some point on this two-dimensional, picture, if you will. And what is multiplication? Well, it's just repeated addition, right? So if you want to take the base point, here's a picture of this, right? If you want to take a base point P and add like multiply it by 10, what you do is you add it just to itself 10 times, right? And so what happens here is, well, if the point is itself, then you cannot connect 2 points like you did here, but instead you just have a tangent, right? Both points are the same, like on the same place. That's why you get this tangent line here. And but you can still say, okay, my addition of p with p, oops, my addition of p with p is the, come on, is cutting the line at this point, and then I've reflected down, and this is my p plus p, right? So this is 2p. And then if I want to get 3p, well, I take 2p, which is this point, and 1p, and they connect those lines. It will cut here and then mirror up. Maybe it does that. Yeah, exactly here. So this is 3p, and now I can go on. 4p would be connect those lines, this point. Come on. Sorry. Yeah, he doesn't take it further, but you can see, right? This multiplication is just repeated addition, and for me, my multiplication, quotes and quotes, is just by exponentiation. So g times g 14 times, this would create me my new number here. And once you have your 10p wherever it lies, it will be some point on the elliptic curve, then you have two coordinates, x and y. And if I'm not correct, wrong, then the x coordinate of this point that you get after 10 times p, this is the some number, right, on the x axis, and that's your private key, your public key. Sorry, that's your public key. So if you have a private key, right, this number to multiply the base point, like in this case, p is the base point. If you have a private key, you multiply the private key by this base point, which means repeated addition. then you can generate the public key, because it's just the coordinate of the result of this addition. And this addition you can do very efficiently. Namely, what you do is, I mean, he explains it here, I think, to get to 10p, you really only need to get to, you know, you don't need to add 10 p times p, but you can actually jump, you know, you go from p to 2p, from 2p, adding 2 p's together, you get to 4p, and from 4p, you get to 8p, and suddenly you're at 10p, but you didn't have to add 9 times p to p, you could do it in just 3 steps, because you can do this, you know, exponential rundown to 10p, and that's why this number, despite being actually multiplied, quote unquote, is also called exponent. And you see, going from a private key to a public key is very fast and very easy, but going from the public key to the private key, like finding the number to be multiplied by the base to get to the right x coordinate, this is virtually impossible. And this is where the hardness comes in. Similar here, right? So this, of course, this is just an analogy, and it kind of breaks down because we can do exponentiation quickly. But in a world where going from a number to the exponent is hard, this would be, like, by definition, irreversible, right? So if I tell you, hey, here is this number 478 2 9 6 9, find me the magic number, you know, f, so that g to the power of f equals this number. Well, this is not trivial. I mean, you can do it with a computer easily, and in this case the number is so small that you can just, you know, brute force it and you will get there. But the idea is that this multiplication, like taking the power off, is just multiplication, and you get fast. In the other direction, it's hard. So this is one feature that makes the going from the results, the public key to the private key, hard. Okay, so that's that. But now, how to get to the signature, right? So, okay, we have said that let's call the, like, here, of course, there's no coordinates, and so in this exponential case, I'm just dealing with some numbers and not actually playing around with coordinates on the x, y axis. But let's call, nevertheless, our public key x, and the public key is the base point to the power of the private key, as we said, right? So the x would be that. I can share this one. I will not share my d. Nobody knows my d. I mean, I know, we know between us two it's 14, but nobody else knows, right? So let's say I have a message that I want to sign, right? The message would be some information, right? Like m equals, you know, I love cake. This is my message. Or, you know, let's go with I want to send Harry 7 Bitcoin. Okay, this is the message that should be broadcast on the network, right? This would be in the Bitcoin case, this byte string saying, you know, I want to take this transaction and this amount of money and send it. And this would be translated to some number. Well, I can try and attempt to go from this there. So, you know, we can do hex for, no, yeah, hex character for character in M. To cast it to ord. So this is a sequence of bytes. So it starts with 4920771. So this is some hex in encoded information. And, you know, we can cast it to a number and so on. I guess by now you know you can take any information and and encoded in some string or some number, right? So let's say this message is encoded eventually in the number 15. Just to stick with a small number, for you have seen that the message in the Bitcoin case was long, but let's stick with, like, my message is 15. And so now I will actually do the following. If you want to you know, sign, you know, I agree with this message. I agree with this message. I want to send Harry 7 Bitcoin, or, you know, I agree with this message, quote unquote, 15. Then what you do is you produce a pair of numbers. This will be R and S, and this R and S will relate to each other in a way that incorporate the private key. Right, our private key is D, and I will be able to create these numbers, and they will be such that if I don't have access to the private key, then it would be like going from public key to private key, computationally infeasible to even create these two numbers. So, and how this looks like for this you know, exponential simplification is as follows. We take our public key, right? X was this number, this public. No, this was the base point to the power of the private key. And now we random generate, this is what the wallet does, we random generate any number R, right? The number R is effectively a random number, and it should be, for security sake, a new number every time. Whenever you sign with your private key, you generate a new number. So let's say R is the number, I don't know, the number 7, right? Again, this is not secure in any way, but this is for example. So what we do is we take the public key, we deck the public key to the power of R, and we multiply, like, we can check what comes out here if you want. This is this long number. But we take this number and we multiply it by the base point to the power of the message. And you have seen in the Bitcoin case, what goes in here is not actually necessarily the message, but some trace of the message. What they were using was a hash of the message, but it doesn't really matter, right? So the hash of the message would also just be some byte array or some number, right? Is it all the same thing? So we take the message directly here in our case. So we have this expression. What comes out? Okay, this is this number. Okay, so the thing is this. We have seen this rule of exponentiation, right? We have seen this rule here. This rule is basically a lemma of the above rule, right? So if you take a base to a power and then again to another power, this is the same as multiplying the two powers that you chose. And what this implies is, since the public key is secretly just the base to the private key, right? This implies that this thing here is the base to the power of the private key, because that's just the public key, right? This thing is just X. So if you take that to the power of R times G to the power of M, then this is the same thing, right? This is exactly the same thing. So by the rule that we just had, we know that this is also the same as this, right? So I just applied this rule, and by the other rule, like by the above rule, we know that this is the same as this, right? It's all the same thing. So knowing, like, since I created the public key, since I know how to resolve the X into G to the power of D, I can say, here I define an S, which is D times R plus M, right? And then I can say, well, if you take my public key to the power of this number, and then the message. I can also tell you another number, namely s, so that g to the power of s, this will be the same thing, right? So here, the s has the information of the private key, right? S has the information of the private key. It comes down to implicitly creating the public key. So this is like fundamentally the same thing, like only expressed in two ways. And if division and taking the logarithm of this expression is hard, which in the case of the, you know, this is just an analogy, in the case of the elliptic curve it is, then only the guy who or girl who knows about D is able to say, okay, give me any R and I will give you an S so that these numbers fit together, right? So the signature consists of some random number R and a number S, which could only have been produced by the knowledge of D, right? Since going the other way is so hard. Again, this is also something that can easily be verified, right? If I say like, oh, by the way, here's these two numbers, you can verify that I know the private key because you can take my public key, right? It's public. You can take the R, I just give it to you. You can, of course, take the message that I wanted to sign, right? I give you the signature together with the message. You can compute this thing. And you can, of course, also, you know, take the base point and take this S, which I just gave you. And so in this way, you prove that you know about the private key, because only you with the private key were able to create the S. And it can be verified by, oh, yeah, he must be in possession of the private key because he was able to create this S. Again, you know, I emphasize this is just an analogy and it's not safe because actually taking the logarithm here is not hard. Like my computer can do it. But the elliptic curve operation, like the elliptic curve exponentiation, which is, you know, this elliptic curve multiplication, this is actually a process that's hard. Maybe you want to rewatch that again. I don't know to what extent it was a good explanation, but I think I made this point, this kind of, you know, the pretty thing is that you have this one-way operations, more or less, like if the... NSA conspiracy theory. No, but if the elliptic curve is like a general one, and if nobody found out how to, you know, actually crack elliptic curve cryptography, like if not secretly there's a mathematical trick nobody saw till now and it is actually easy to invert and stuff, assuming that's not the case, then the elliptic curve cryptography amounts to being able to generate a number S given any number R that verifies that you control a private key. The private key also just being a number. Okay, so I think we are now at the end of the video. I mean, I could of course, you know, say more about the elliptic curves, but basically, you know, maybe I can do a contour plot here. Contour. Because here, you know, I took this, like, the Bitcoin elliptic curve is given by y to the power of 2 being equal to x to the power of 3 plus 7. This is the specification of the Bitcoin elliptic curve, except, and that this is the caveat, right? You only look at integers, and also you don't take infinitely large numbers, but you cut them off. You take the modular arithmetic operation of all the numbers which exceed a certain huge number, a huge prime number. And I will not go into detail about that now. But basically, if you are interested in that, then you can see that here also goes into an explanation about that. So it's the elliptic curve. Like if you want to have a picture, it will not actually look like this, because this is like a smooth curve and we are only dealing with discrete numbers, so it cannot look like a smooth curve. And beyond that, because points that exceed a certain number are like mirrored back by modular arithmetic, it will look actually much more chaotic and it will kind of look like that. But the points are still there, you know. Some of the points are part of the curve and some are not. And the curve is fundamentally this one. And I'm not sure if my Wolfram Alpha will plot that. Let's see. Yeah, nice. So I took the square root of both sides. Like I plotted y equals the square root of x to the power of 3 plus 7. But in reality, it must be something symmetric, right? Because to compute addition of the points, you have to mirror around and such. This was the final note on the discreteness of the actual curve being used. And so yeah, here, you know, this is the big number that after which you repeat, right? You don't take any numbers bigger than that. And you know, I say number, it looks like a bunch of Fs, but that's just because it's hex. Then a generic elliptic curve will look like that. Y to the power of 2 plus x to the power of 3 plus a times x plus b. In the case of the Bitcoin curve, the a is chosen to be 0, right? The NIST or the NSA or whoever designed it said, well, let's not use an a. So this term is actually not there because it's just 0. And b, it's funny enough, it's just, you know, it's just 7. And they have this funky way of writing it down. Base point, you know, you have this compressed and uncompressed formats. They might depend on if you look at both coordinates or only one coordinate. This is just details. And then you have the order, which is like the number you can multiply the base to come back. So this is also, you know, the numbers you want to multiply the base point with should not exceed this number and whatnot. And finally, like, let's take it to the test and let's go down back to the elliptic curve signature page and read the algorithm, right? We should now be able to understand the algorithm with some caveats. So, no. Signature. Yeah. So, okay, let's read that. Suppose Alice wants to send a signed message to Bob. Initially, they must agree on a curve parameters. So the curve is, in Bitcoin case, in most cryptocurrency cases, what we just had, y to the power of 2 equals x to the power of 3 plus 7, a base point, because, right, there is some base point, but effectively many points can act as base point, right? A point that you multiply with. And then the order, and this should fit together, right? The order that defines basically the when you don't go over this number. In addition to the field and equation of the curve, the field is how, like, which kind of multiplication you use. We need a base point. Yeah, exactly. Okay, this is just that. He explains it. Oh, yeah, he explains it. There must be prime number. Da da da. This is also the way in which you multiply. You know how you jump to back if the numbers get too big. And here is then the algorithm. Okay. Alice creates a key pair consisting of a private key integer. So if you tell about your private key, if you tell about your public key and you keep your private key, which is usually what you do if you do cryptocurrencies, right? You don't, you know, throw away the private key often. Then you have just your private key D, and you know, in Bitcoin it will start with L or a K or something like that if it's base 58 encoded. And right, your private key should not be the number one, right? You can use the number one as private key, but then people will, you know, look at the private key list and maybe check out, hey, was somebody stupid enough to take the number one as private key? Let's try it. So it should be something in this range, and this range is, you know, is some huge range. Let's actually see how big that is. Well, it says it here, right? It's basically if you would write it down as a string of zeros and ones, then it would have 200 65 zeros or ones, right? It's as long as a SHA-2 actually. So let's see. He will not take it because there are the blanks there. Okay, let's skip that. Good. So now we have a private key. This D, and in our case here, that was just a small number, but usually it will be some large number. And a public key curve point, right? So private key times base point is a public key. We can use the node X by as the multiplication. For Alice to sign a message, she does the following steps. So we take the message, you know, I want to send 7 Bitcoin to Harry. We hash it. This is called Eden. Okay, this is SHA-2, is one of the hash functions also used in most cryptos. Then we produce another number set, and set is also basically a part of the hash, right? Here says set is the L leftmost bits of E, where L is the blah, blah, blah. So this is like in our case, we just here, we just work with M all the way. What they do here is they hash it and then throw away bits. But essentially, set is still just a message. It's just a trace of the message. Then we use a random number, right? The random number in our case was R. What was R? 7 in our case. But here they generate a random number. This is called K because it's also one of the multiplication numbers here. So the algorithm is a little bit different because they go on and make it more complicated. But essentially, this is our R. Then calculate another point on the curve by multiplying this number by the base point. And then our R is their X component of this base point, modulo N. It should not be zero, okay. And then calculate S. And so this is also, like, this is basically the same thing. It's just a tiny bit different. We didn't have a K at all, right? So they have another K, like an inverted K there. Since I was dealing with integers here, I did not want to do any division, so I skipped that part. But basically they say K times S equals message plus R times D. So this is basically what we had, except one more K there. But still, you know, the K and the R are closely related. So is again, the S is derived from all the other letters, so to speak. Yeah, that's it, basically. The signature is then these two numbers. And if you have these two numbers, then here they make some comments on that. This means you must be in the possession of the private key D, which is involved there. And then, you know, they also describe the verification. So how to do the check. In our analogy case, the check would just be exponentiate on both sides and check if there's the same thing comes out. And here's the same thing, right? Except you have the elliptic curve multiplication. And they also make some interesting remarks that you should never, you know, if you use the same random number again, like if as I create one signature, right? My first signature was RS, which was that. if I go ahead and create another message, like my new message is, let's say 55, right? This is, I send, 2 Bitcoin to Shimon, right? And if I generate another S now, right, then I would have R and S. I would have another signature now signing another message. But the problem is then I can go backwards. I can say, oh, well, you know, if you used the same, a different M, but the same R, I can say, okay, what if, I don't know, you know, there is some, you can then subtract and then do the difference, and then you can figure out, what is actually the private key, just by going backwards, reverse engineering. And then they say that apparently PlayStation 3 actually was doing that. They were like, they were like not using a random R, but they were just hard coding the R and using it for all signatures. And so somebody could, you know, hack the PlayStation 3 or reverse engineer the signature and open everything up. Okay, so I'm sorry for this long-ish video. Yeah, almost 2 hours. But we covered a lot of ground, and I'm pretty sure there's a lot of information that people haven't looked into much in the past. So thank you for listening to, and I'm very happy if you guys you can ask me questions or engage and tell me what I should talk about in the next one. Take care.